guys, welcome to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGIO Powersports and FMF Racing. I'm Don Maeda, and I'm joined today by seven-time AMA National and Supercross champ, Jeff Ward. So, seven, dude, that's like, when you're a little kid, were you like ever thinking that you'd have that title?
No, I mean, as a kid, when I was growing up, the future, there was barely even a future in motocross at that point. Mm-hmm. So just wanted to get to where my idols were, and as of right now, sad point, Marty Smith. Mm-hmm. First off, like, to my condolences to their family, and he was the reason why I was racing at the time. I mean, mm-hmm. I was with mini bikes, and he was the first American really hero in motocross, and that's who I emulated or wanted to be. If you look at my pictures, I had the electro helmet, the Carrera goggles, the Bel-Ray patch on the same side. So it was like, that's how you wanted to, you know, what I wanted to do. But at the time, professionally thinking, because I mean, I think he was a professional, but really I hadn't gone far enough in the States to show that that's how you could make a living, or that was a goal to shoot for. And nothing was ever in my mind of being a Supercross champion. I mean, Supercross was barely getting going at that point.
Yeah.
It was just kind of more of a show or a circus show or, you know, and to get that seven championships was way up and above what I ever really predicted for myself or even shot for until it got to a point really where I realized, I can do this. And then it was just, I was just business as usual, trying to win. And if that came with it, then great, but just wanting to be the best I could be.
Yeah. I think a lot of people, their first time they ever saw you, or a lot of people my age, was the long
wheelie.
Stand-up wheelie and on any Sunday. Do you remember that day and filming that?
Yeah, there's very few things I remember in my mini bike days, but that was one of them, because Saddleback Park, they had a track way in the back. It was more of a TT track. It had a couple left-hand, you know, and a right-hander with a jump in it, and I was back there ripping around. I think we were at a trials event. That's why that trials rider, you know, the foot on it, and that girl, I was there and saw him going up the hill. I was on the flat, the TT track, and then I'm like, I can do a wheelie like that. So I'd go, did some wheelies. They only had a little bit of it in there, but I went all the way up the hill and over, and then I kind of came back and they flagged me down. I'm like, what? And he goes, can you do that a couple more times or three or four more times? So I said, yeah. So I did that couple long wheelies up over the top, and then I just took off and rode around.
Did your own thing.
Just didn't know what they were for, or who they were, or never even thought twice of it. And then the movie came out, and we went to watch the movie.
Oh, and you didn't know you were going to be in it?
No, I didn't know I was going to be in it.
Oh, wow.
So we're just watching, then all of a sudden there I was, and we all freaked out, and then we stayed, you know, stayed in the theater till it restarted again to watch the beginning of it, and then left, and that's kind of how it went. I didn't have any idea, or signed any papers or did anything.
Yeah, right?
It's
funny, different times back then.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it would have mattered if I didn't go on to do what I did. I mean, there's so many people in that movie of maybe who knows what they've done or where they've went or could have done something big, I don't know, but I think it was just lucky that I was able to win championships, and then it's kind of goes back that I was in that movie, and it kind of parallels together, I guess.
I mean, kind of a silly question, but have your kids seen on any Sunday and seen you in that?
Yeah, I still pop down again. It'll pop up on YouTube, and then you just start watching. Next thing you know, you're an hour and a half into it.
Yeah.
Even though you know every outcome, it's just pretty cool on how they narrated it and the music. And there's just never really been a movie since then that portrayed kind of motorcycling or, you know, the life of motorcycling. And they've seen it. And just like everything else, I'm just dad, so.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, hey, man, crazy times that we're in right now. Obviously, we're in the middle of a quarantine and, a pandemic with this COVID-19 thing. How has this whole shutdown of the sport or society affected you?
Not as much as others. You know, own big, you know, businesses and rely. I mean, I'm still in the motorcycle industry. People are still riding. Mm-hmm. I still train. I still work, you know, help out people. So, socially it has, but it doesn't stress a little bit more stress, I guess. But my daughter's home from college. You know, can't finish out. Had to do that home line. My son's in the Orange County Sheriff, so he's only going a couple of days a week. And then my son's in the military. He says he's so things change for them more than myself, but not as much as probably a lot of other people have. Mm-hmm. It's just an awkward situation and something nobody's ever been through, or I don't think anybody knows where it's going to go from here.
Yeah.
I mean, it's still, every day is something new, and there's this and there's that, and nobody can agree, and it's, you know, I don't know what to expect down the road, but it's just unfortunate, and I'm sure we'll look back a couple year, whatever it gets going, and realize what they did wrong and what they did right, and if there's ever something similar to it, I guess then maybe we prepare. It just seems like we're never prepared for something that we think we're prepared for.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I don't think they could predict this. I think everybody predicts we need the X amount of this for hospitals, X amount of that. But then when it goes up and beyond, then there's a panic and we didn't prepare. It's like earthquakes. We don't know. We all got our 10 gallons of water, whatever it is. But if a big one happens, I don't think we're ever going to imagine it could have been that big.
Yeah.
Or we're not prepared, or that, you know, there's just so many things that are going to come up. So it's just really unfortunate. And hopefully somebody smarter than me figures out what to do. So,
You know, I was thinking at one point, I was wondering one day, I was like, I wonder when, because like at the point, I personally knew nobody that had caught coronavirus. And I was thinking, well, I wonder when the first person in the motorcycle industry is going to get it, or first racer, or first, and literally that day is when Rick Johnson came on and said, I had it. So, I mean, have you talked to RJ?
Yeah, I talked to him. I was in Daytona with him, hugging him, talking, high-fiving, and then he said, I started feeling sluggish after my ride there, and I'm like, well, I was there, and I've been kind of sick before that, and my daughter had cough for a month, and I have no friends that were down cycling that lost 30 pounds, and I'm like, you had to have it.
Yeah.
So I think it's circulated, and I may, you know, I haven't got tested yet, but yeah, it's just, I think once it comes down to it, you really got, I mean, when you get older, I mean, I'm almost 60, you really start thinking about your health more than anything. That's the most important thing you can have in your life is your health, because nothing else matters if you got bad health. So I don't know, maybe it's an eye opener to where people are getting sick and dying. You know, I mean, elderly is elderly, but you can also be a healthy elderly.
Yeah.
And if you don't take your body seriously through your young age and up to where you get there, you're in a vulnerable situation no matter what it is.
Yeah.
Just walking up hills or going in altitude, you could have a heart attack. So maybe it's opening up eyes to maybe where health is way more important than people thought. And maybe they, now the people that are older, wishing you can't, you know, wish you would have taken better care of yourself when you're younger. So I'm really healthy. I'm not scared of it.
Yeah.
I'm not, you know, I'm more scared of cancer. My family's had cancer. My mom and dad dies of cancer. My mother-in-law died of cancer. Her dad got, you know, so I'm more scared of of that.
And didn't you have like a bout with?
I had melanoma cancer and had to have lymph nodes taken out, and I'm still on chemo medicine, and it still affects me. But so yeah, I'm maybe a candidate for having a problem from catching the.
But I'm super, super healthy.
You know, I say if I had something, I would have died on the hill yesterday.
So that's
my mentality.
Right? Okay, just, so I remember like it was probably like 6 or 7 years ago. I remember talking to you, and you're like, oh, you're really like hooked on this mountain biking, huh? And it was kind of weird because you weren't really at that point, and then you started, and now you're just so gnarly.
Well, I mean, I trained, that was my regimen when I was training with cycling. I did triathlons. Yeah. I was a super strong cyclist, good runner. So my fitness was good, and I loved cycling. Then when I got into IndyCars, you know, the physical ability to win races wasn't on your physical ability, it was the car.
Yeah.
My physical training from my years past, I didn't have to do anything to suffer through that. There was no suffering. So I still cycled, but it was just as more for fun, get out and do cycles, but I never took it regimentally or went out every day and racked up the miles and got fanatic about it. And then I just went a long period of time. I just put on, you know, did off-road trucks, even Supermoto. I wasn't in as shape as I am now. Just my riding ability got me through that. And but then I went ride. I had some friends that, well, Johnny Louch was one of them. Had a good friend up in Peter and Adderton, a bunch of guys at mountain. He's like, you got to come mountain biking with us. And I'm like, yeah. So then I went, and you know, I'm super. The first warm up hill, you know, of course I'm going thinking I got these guys. And then about half, you know, they do 2 hours. I haven't done 2 hours in a long time, and it was hot. And halfway through, I was just dead. I was done. These guys were beating me. I was just like, and that was it. It was like, oh, I'm out of shape. I got to get going. For that was like 2000. 13 or 14 and then from there I just been going.
Yeah.
And now it's just a way of life again. So it wasn't that I was out of shape. I was just out of cycling shape. Mm-hmm. Be like Carmichael's getting back into it. You just imagine how much weight you drop. Mm-hmm. You know, or you didn't realize how much weight you put on just because you were still kind of eating the same and living the same lifestyle, but not training like you did when you were racing.
Yeah.
So, but yeah, I just really enjoy it. It's just...
It's funny how when you were racing, it was something you had to do. And now you're doing it because you love to do it, right? You love that suffering feeling.
Right, yeah. I mean, that's... I love challenges, you know, and I go do the local races and, you know, and it's not even about who you beat or how you get beat. It's just like how you felt during it. And, you know, when you're half certain point in where you're collapsing and you're more mad at you didn't... must not trained hard enough or did something. I'm just kind of hit or miss right now, just going out every day and blowing up and then really tired. And I don't have a theory at all, but I am now going to be kind of hiring the cycling coach that is going to keep me more in check so I don't overdo stuff.
Uh-huh.
So now I'm kind of taking it a little more serious. And I just want to see where I can get to be more comfortable with being uncomfortable and learning technique. And, you know, a lot of guys I ride with, cycling guys on the road, are used to be world-class athlete cyclists, and they can just kill you, damage you anytime they want. Mm-hmm. And I can stand there certain times, and then other times I get dropped, and then I'm like in the second pack. And I want to see if I can hang in there at some point. So, you know, just trying to do something more regiment, just more scientific type of it, to where I just overdo it.
Yeah.
I can't go out and do a easy ride and some guy will come by me on a bike and bam, I'm on him. It's like, it's like all of a sudden, no, you're not beating me.
Yeah.
You know, they're going up the hill. It's just that mental thing of like, oh, he thinks he's got me, you know? And it's like, okay. And then next thing you know, you've got your heart rate up and you're sprinting, and then you're like, well, that blew that whole, you know, rest day.
Yeah.
So I'm going to try to stick to that and see where it goes and have some fun with it.
Do you cycle much with Johnny O? Because, I mean, I know you guys lifelong rivals in racing.
Yeah, we used to do quite a bit. This time, you know, we went out with Victor, with Sheldon last week, and Kurt Rude, and we invited Johnny, and he's like, no, I want to stick by the house because of what's going on. You know, he just didn't want... Johnny's always the type of guy that likes to be in his little area, even when we were racing. But we've gone out quite a bit, a lot, but we'll be at the same races. I pick him up at the house sometimes. We drove to a couple Dirty 30s or the Filthy 50. And,
we
keep in touch all the time, but he's got his little program and he's training his riders, so it's kind of hard and to get to, you know, get together and do it. But there's still a lot of other people that we get hooked up with that are old friends from motorcycle days.
Cool. Well, hey, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors, but when we come back, we're going to talk racing, of course. Hey, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGIO Powersports and FMF Racing. I'm joined by seven-time champ Jeff Ward here. So you spent your entire career on Kawasaki, motocross, supercross career, but you started on Suzuki, right? Your first...
Yeah, to go way back, I was with Honda. I was their factory guy. I was with Honda for quite a while at the XR75 with the four-stroke racing against ADCC two-strokes. So
you raced the XR75 against 80.
That was, yeah, I had to run against them. So you look at it now, you know, you have a 450 against a 250 two-stroke. So it's like I need to double the CCs on the four-stroke to be supposedly the way it is now to be even. So, yeah, we had to be pretty creative with my dad. I mean, we ran nitro. We did lightened flywheels, cranks. I got stitches in my leg here from or my crank flywheel blew up from the nitro. The mixture was too strong, so it backfired and blew the whole side of the motor out and all the metal into my leg.
Oh my God.
So we were trying to get as much horsepower out of those things, and then at some point it just became to where, you know, but it really taught me how to ride, override and be comfortable, because I had to not shut off. You know, I mean, the corners would be shut off, just the momentum, I had to really rely on that. So that really helped me out. And with my trials background, even before that, so I had feet on the peg, standing up, momentum, which really helped me out. And then we went to Suzuki. My dad, we had Jeff Ward Racing Products at the time building the Mini Elsinores, which were really fast in the Super Mini class, because we sleeved down the 125 to 110cc. That was a really good bike. And then we even tried to sleeve down a 125 to an 85, two-stroke. It was just too slow. It just, it just wasn't working, too heavy. So we, my dad sold the company to Donnie Emler, FMF. They merged in. That's why they got, like, the, if you have the old catalogs, I'm up front, the FMF, and it has Jeff Ward Racing, the Honda. So they kind of merged in, and I rode Suzuki's at the time. The 80s were out, and then we dominated with that Suzuki 80. It was a really pretty good bike. So then I raced the Nationals that year, and the next year, it was 76, I think, or 77, 78, I believe, my first year on the Nationals, I was riding Suzuki. I did local races with Suzuki. You know, I was getting pretty good. I was getting some help from, I think it was even Pat Alexander was even back then. I can't even remember who it was back then. But they were giving me some bikes and parts. And of course, FMF had a fast bike with all their guys they had. So then we went to the first Nationals. I was on Suzuki's for the first half of the year and did pretty well. I mean, my first race, I got smoked. I got a whole shot of both motos and got lapped both motos. And I don't think I got top 10. Second race at Racing World, they moved the track up the top where my practice track was, and I think I ended up third overall or fourth. I ran up front the whole time with Brock, and Chandler, I think, won that day, Magoo. So I, all of a sudden, I just realized I can run with these guys, and then I was doing okay, and then halfway through the season, Yamaha picked me up saying they wanted to have me for the following year. So I went to stock Yamahas, which they were really bad. So I went from like doing pretty good to even now worse again. So it was frustrating, and you know, some of the hot races killed me. And then the last two races of the year, Brock was in the hunt for the championship with Barnett. So they wanted me to kind of, if I could get up in there and help Brock out, if I could beat Barnett, or if I had to let Brock by or something, just so I was on the team, you know, in the hunt. So I got to ride his OW Works bike at Charlotte, the first National. I led the whole race till two turns from the end, and a lapper pushed me to the right, and Galen Mosier was on me on the Cowie at the time and passed me for the win. So I got second, my first moto on that bike. The next moto I was leading, and the throttle stuck, and I cartwheeled over some jump, so I DNF'd. So then the next week I was, you know, having to help Brock or try to help Brock with the, I can't remember how it came out, but Barnett had ended up winning, I think, the championship. But so that was just like, okay, I'm going to be factory next year, and I can win moto, I can win a championship, or the bike was that good. So this kind of went on and on. I think my dad was maybe talking to him, or we're waiting. It was almost in November, middle of November, and then they called up and said that we want to ride you ride for the team, but we can't supply the works bikes. And I'm like, well, you saw how I did on the production bike. Wasn't even top 10 to where I could almost win on that bike. And they just said, well, we just kind of afford it. I don't know what the reason was, or I just, so I was bummed and went home, and then went riding up to the Racing World where we had the National, and I was up there, and Weinert was at the top of the hill. I remember Weinert pulling up, and Jimmy Weinert talking, what's going on and what's happening? And I said, I'm not riding for Yamaha next year. They didn't have a works bike, and I don't know what I'm doing. And so we left. And then when I got, by the time I got home, I don't know where I went. You had the phone recorder back then. You had to push me. No mobile phones. Push the recorder, and it was, I think Dennis David is, or no, it was, who was it at Kawasaki at the time? Johnson, not Mark Johnson, but it was the team manager, asked me to come down. They wanted to talk to me for the next year, so I went down, and I signed that day before I left. And I stayed with them for, what was it, 13 years then it would have been? So yeah, so if it wasn't for, I mean, you know, it worked out great, but they weren't gonna have a 125 rider that next year. Their 125 wasn't that, I mean, Galen Mosier was not the guy to ride the 125. So maybe they weren't going to have it because they didn't have a rider that was going to, you know, race for him. So then that's how it started.
Yeah. You know, so my motocross, my interest in motocross was started, you know, obviously my brother Ross was racing you know, just see the magazines looking at them or whatever. But one of the things that stuck in my mind was when you were an ad for Cinesolo, and you were in all white.
Right.
Right. Was that a warty thing? Like, did you want to wear all white, or was that them using you to market the white gear?
I don't know.
Weren't you like the guy that made white boots?
I think Osho did, really. I think Johnny, when he was Mugen, he was all white and had the red, like the red motor. And I think he had his gaiters were maybe red, but white. And then the white. So I think he was more of the white, and I thought it was pretty cool. And I don't know if, you know, I have no idea if it was Cinesolo. I think it was Cinesolo. I just had white, white pants, and then the white boots came out, which were rare.
Yeah.
I think because Johnny had the gaiter, so he could put the white gaiters over, even though if he had red boots or black boots. But then they came out, I think maybe the first ones with white boots. So the white boots were, you know, more supposed to be in dirt, you know. So I think maybe they came out with that. And then putting that all on, it just kind of came. And then I went with like a plain white helmet.
Yeah.
Pure white helmet with the sticker number 4 on it, I think, and, or 9 maybe the year before, and the 125. And yeah, it just kind of stuck with that color, and that was kind of my style. Was just, I wasn't flashy, so I thought like the white with just the fluorescent green Cali, and then just the green, just so that popped, and that was the only thing, instead of going colors everywhere. And it just kind of stuck, and it pretty much stuck through my whole career.
Yeah,
I mean, even in the 85 it was still white with, you know, and 86 it's kind of the same thing. Everything was just cut. Even Troy, I didn't get till probably after I got rid of the open face to the full face, Troy started doing more flat, you know, some flames and whatever else. But before that, it was just plain white with a couple green stripes, you know, around it. And that was it, and a number.
Yeah.
It's just kind of cool.
You were the, weren't you like the last like high level guy to hold out with open face helmet?
Probably. I mean, I was even wearing the Showy helmet a couple years after they stopped making the full face or selling them. So at some point it came to like, we can't pay you. You're not wearing the helmet we sell. And then they had an ugly helmet, you know, the square
it
front
Dubok
used to wear. It was like Darth Vader.
And
I was just refusing to wear it. And Troy's like, God, you got it. What, you know, and it's like, well, then he took it and sawed it, you know, sanded it down and made a new piece. And then he started working, making them for Showy, I think. And so, till they started doing that, that was probably 89. It was open face 89. Maybe halfway through, and then when I went to 500s, I think I put the helmet on, or the full face then, when it got nice. But I didn't wear it because of protection. I like the open face just because of the air. And I just, that's all I've ever. But I wore full faces when I was a kid, though. I had the Bell Star. And there's even some pictures of me at Kawasaki back a few times with the Bell full face at a couple of nationals. I think I wore a whole year in the nationals. Then I went back to full open face. I don't know. I don't know the reasoning, but. Why? Maybe because I went with Bell one year, and they didn't have an open or didn't want the open face.
Yeah, so like, you know, you think back to things that made an impression on you when you were younger, and like there was an Oakley ad with you.
Yeah.
Side shot, you had the goggles and the nose beak and the Jofa.
Yeah.
So I was like, I have to have that set up. You know.
It was Osho and Barnett. They had the four, and Johnson, all three ads, the fighter pilot, whatever it was, the theme.
But the whole Jofa thing. I mean, Jofa was obviously to protect you from a rock hitting your mouth, right? But was it you or was it Osho that would always flick it off partway through the motor?
I take it off. I made it loose where it held up, you know, had that little strap.
Yeah.
You could hold it here, and then if you got the whole shot, you're out front. You dropped it, and then it just fell. So it was, I was only holding it up through my jaw.
Yeah.
And then when you didn't need it, you let it fall down. But yeah, I saw shots where it's just you just pop it off and unhook it. And it just flaps. A lot of the supercrosses, I never even wore it.
Yeah.
Just goggles with the beak because there's really no roost and you're not going wide open uphill. So it was just comfortable not to have it.
But, did you realize that back then that you were like influencing people and setting styles?
No, I wasn't. I mean, I only I know Bailey, like stickers, you know, putting them on the right spot. And it was just fun, like designing the helmet and making it look cool. But I wasn't thinking like, oh, this is gonna, everybody's gonna wear this next year when I do this design. Or I'm not a designer. I'm not like somebody that's trying to build something that'll sell a product. You know, I was just trying to look cool, you know, whatever looked kind of cool at the time. And it's kind of cool because you look back and those photos still look cool. I mean, 125, it's just the green, and the white and everything just looks clean.
Super clean,
just looks clean. And then you go to some areas where, you know, when it went to all that colors and neon and helmet, it just looks like a splash of like sprinkling paint everywhere. Yeah. I mean, it was an era. I think I got caught up in it. I'm sure I had pink, you know, on the legs or whatever. And then it kind of went to the black era. I had black leathers. But everything was more solid on me. I never had, like, cut-up stuff. It was always a solid color. So, I just tried to keep things kind of clean. And it's kind of a cool era that you look back and it still looks pretty good.
The other thing I always think of when I think of you is there's a photo at a Supercross, and I think it was a motocross action. You're landing, your nose down, landing from a jump, and you already had your leg out.
Right.
And I remember I was like, oh, that's so sick.
Yeah, it was in, I think, in New Jersey. It was just that corner, there is a bridge, it turns left, there's a tunnel bridge on the left there. So. And there's like a, guys were going outside and jumping and then rolling over and making the berm. And I went outside and I had to land on the downside. And then I had to get in that rut. Otherwise you'd skid up into where the bridge was, the tunnel. So I only did that like 3 or 4 times that I could make the corner because it was so hard. Uh-huh. Otherwise you went inside and just jumped and then landed and tucked under. But the outside was faster if you did it, but nobody could land it right. And then I got it a few times and somebody snapped that, but it was super hard to be that committed where the landing wasn't real steep, you know. It wasn't like it was long and went straight for 10 yards and you got to hit the brake and skid and turn. It was as soon as you landed you were in this rut, and a couple of times I clipped it. So I was sitting down. When you're sitting down it just throws you forward. And I hit it a few times. I don't even know if it was in the main events or if that's practice or it's like practice because the fans, it doesn't look like there's a lot of fans, but yeah, it was just a cool shot that somebody got, and it's still a pretty cool picture today.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's hard to do.
One of the coolest days for me was I was at Troy Lee's picking something up, I think. I was in the showroom, and that was when he still had all of your works Kawasaki's in the showroom. I don't know, were they on loan from Cowie or something, or you?
Yeah, they're at the museum or something now, yeah.
But it was super cool, because then I like looked up and I'm all, oh, hey, Jeff Ward, what's up? And we started talking about the bikes, and you were giving me the rundown of all the bikes.
Yeah.
Like, oh, this one sucked because of this, or this was good because of that. So through your career, what bike stands out to you as the best works bike you rode?
The 125 84. Was just a little bit better than the 83, but then 85, the 250 that we had. I hadn't ridden outdoor 250, of course, that year. I won the championship and the Supercross, but it seemed like the 125 transferred over into the 250. Mm-hmm. But the 250 was just like a perfect bike. It was just, to compete with the Honda bikes, well, you had to have at least a bike that was equal, because their riders were talented, David and Johnny and all the other guys on there. So I was always behind that curve with my bike in the Cowies from 81 82 8. We didn't have the bike just was not as good as Honda. Everything was seemed like Cowie was always a year behind with water cool disc brakes. Honda always came out with hydraulic, you know. They always had something we didn't have.
And
it always seemed like their bikes were just spot on, and it took a while to where Cowie got up to that level, and it took me a while to get up to the level of, you know, Hannah and those guys, Barnett, and just a young kid trying to learn. But once it matched, like in 84, even 84, 250 was pretty good. But then it just seemed like I learned so much from that with the 120, and then when 85's bike came in, it was better. The whole package was just like, everything was spot on right then. I wish it could have kept going. Then we went to production rolls in 86, and we went from top back to the bottom again. Honda had a better production bike. I don't know if you know why, but it just seemed, when I raced 83, 84 in the Cowies, I was the only Cowie on the gate. There was no production bikes. That's how bad they were. Nobody rode them because they weren't. Okay. So when that happened, they weren't really developing them like maybe everybody else was. So when we went to the production rule, we hadn't stepped up the game. That's why like in 86, when the Motocross of Nations was selected, they wanted me to ride the 125. Because you had Bailey on the 500, which is the best choice. I didn't ride 500s. You had RJ on the 250, which is the great choice. You went and put me on a 250 and RJ on a 125. I just raced 125s 2 years ago, and I'm still small and light. And we don't have a bike. Nobody's raced this production bike. And then whoever did that year, it was terrible. And I'm like, I'm not going to go on it. I wasn't fighting for another position, doing the strong pull. I'm not going. You need to put me on a 500 or in K kick somebody else out. I just said, no, I don't think it's good for the team for me to be on a 125. And that's when OGIO came in and was kind of pushed out by Honda, and he just killed it. Yeah. I wouldn't have been able to do that.
Yeah.
Not even close. So it was perfect. But then the next opportunity came up in 88 where they wanted me to ride a 125 because you had Lachine on the 500 and then RJ on the 250. And then they asked me to ride the 125, and I wasn't going to turn it down because I saw what Johnny did and I wanted to be there. And I did good. I won my class that day with Jean-Michel Bell, who was just the 125 world champion that year. And so it worked out good. But 85 would be the best bike.
Nice. Hey, in the era of works bikes, was it just like they got shipped from Japan and there was this mysterious box that came? Or did you get to go to Japan and help develop it, the bike that you're going to race?
Well, when I first went there, everything came from Japan. They would come over and they said this was the best thing or this was that the best, and it was usually junk. I mean, I snapped off probably three sets of forks.
Really?
Yeah, down the hill, Carlsbad, testing two-fit, whatever it was, fork snapped off. 500 Saddleback, fork snapped off. I mean, this is gnarly crashes. Think of Carlsbad downhill. You know the first drop off and you're wide open, that second one?
Yeah.
Off that, land, forks, gone.
Gone.
Snapped.
Handlebars in your hand.
Handlebars in your hand, face on the ground, end over end.
Oh.
And then you'd come back all, you know, just, and then, so it went for this. They didn't know the abilities that we had. Their riders tested it, you know, and then we went over there in 83 to do the Japanese GP at Suga. I think it was myself, maybe Barnett, maybe Lachine, I don't know who it was. I won that day, but we lapped their champion twice in the 40-minute moto. So, and then we were jumping stuff that they'd never jumped, you know, they didn't even think of it as a double. Mm-hmm. You know, we were just landing it, and then they realized that, you know, why we're breaking stuff.
Yeah.
So then we started going over around 83, and we did all the testing and weeded out, you know, and then when we got the bikes, then at least they were, for those, in the last 3 years that we had works bikes, were capable of not, you know, we had breaking like that down linkage they used to have with the dog leg, and we called it the dog bone. It had a little screw, you know, you could adjust it, snap, snap. So many of those snapped off, So then they finally figured out they couldn't, you know, because that's the ride height was in those stupid little whatever the things were. You look at it nowadays, you'd say, how'd that thing even
hold up?
Hold up.
Yeah.
And it still did. Once they fixed it, it still did, but they had to re-engineer it. So yeah, once we started going over there, I'd stay there for 5 weeks.
Wow.
It was a long time. And to get the bikes, I mean, we even did that front suspension, you know, with the anti-dive, like Roger. We had that on a 125. It was terrible. So at least we got to weed it out. Otherwise, if they would have liked it, the riders, it would have came over with that on it. And then we would have just freaked out. So that stuff stopped. But still, there was still a lot of stuff that we'd go over there and we just automatically wouldn't even, we'd already done it. Our guys had already tried stuff and then we'd go over and it'd be a waste of time. It was hard to communicate back then. I mean, you had phone calls and I don't know if there was even fax machines. I don't know what there was back then. But it was just hard. The communication was terrible. They say it's terrible now. It's like, how? But the miscommunication and then the language barrier and just the mentality thinking, and our racing is so different from what theirs is, and they think theirs is maybe better. It's just, it was a cluster for a lot of years to where it finally settled down and we got like a good rhythm going of how what we needed to do, and it you know, worked good for me after that.
Cool. Hey Jeff, we're going to take a quick break to hear from our sponsors, but back for one more segment with the Flying Freckle.
We put our heads together to both reimagine and lift the bar on what a modern motocross helmet should be. Opt for the highest level of modern technology and energy dispersion with the Fly Racing Formula Helmet. Designed for an elevated defense against a wider range of real-world impact scenarios. Globally engineered with the most advanced materials and technologies available. Outfit yourself with proven technology, lightweight performance, and elevated impact management with the Fly Racing Formula Helmet.
What's up guys, it's Brock Tickle. I ride for the JGR Yoshimura Factory Suzuki Racing Team, and I'm stoked to be back at the races. Planning my comeback to racing was cool to see. I have a lot of support behind me to get me here. FXR stepped up and invested in me, and I'm stoked to be part of them. FXR honestly kind of blew me away. All the product is awesome. The pants fit me awesome. The best fitting pant I've ever worn, and everything's sublimated and it looks good.
to put our adventures on hold. But now is the perfect time to prepare for their return. Amsoil has your back with fast, free shipping, and ordering has never been easier. Just look up your vehicle, select your product, add an oil change to your cart, and check out. Spend $50 on Amsoil products and shipping is on us. Order now at amsoil.com.
Don't try to be the fastest on the track.
Be the fastest ever. Work harder than everyone else.
Because dedication is everything.
If they say your goals are crazy, be insane.
Be fast.
Be the crazy one.
Be unstoppable.
One goal,
one vision.
Hey, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by OGIO Powersports and FMF Racing. Here with Jeff Ward, motocross legend. I cut the last segment with the nickname, right?
Yeah.
Who gave you the nickname, the Flying Freckle? A, and B, did you like it?
Well, I was young. I was on the helmet actually on any Sunday. Had it in the front that somebody, you know, painted it on there. Pinstriped it on or whatever they did. It had the Flying Scotsman because I'm Scottish, and then it had the Flying Freckle. So I don't know if it was my dad or the painter that painted the helmet. I have no idea who, but I had a ton of freckles.
Yeah.
I mean, I was born in Scotland. We moved over here to Redondo Beach, and I was paler and whiter than a ghost.
Yeah.
You know, I had actually almost blonde hair at the time, and straight to the beach. And then just got fried. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden, you know, the freckles started. And then it was like almost like a whole freckle. It was just so big, you know, and the freckles just grew and grew. And I mean, I still got some of my arms, but it kind of went away. It went away quite a bit when I got older. But yeah, so it was like from when I was 2 years old, 2 and a half, and then it just kind of stuck. But I didn't know, there was a lot of nicknames. They called me the Teeny Meeny, you know, because Team Green. Yeah, a bunch of just, and then Wardy stuck, actually, Goat Brecker gave me that nickname. We were in Japan and we were at a test track playing around, and it was super foggy. We couldn't see 10 feet in front of you, and we had these walkie-talkies, and we were running around like we were, you know, in war, like hiding from each other. And we had all these walkie-talkies, and Goat would always say, you know, something Wardy over, and he'd call me Wardy because, you know, he just couldn't say Ward over, so he started calling me Wardy over, Wardy, and then it just stuck from right there. Then he started calling, you know Goat.
Yeah.
He had a nickname for everybody, and once it stuck, that's all he called you. He never called you by your name anymore.
Yeah.
So Wardy stuck, I don't know, it was like probably 81 or something when he was on the team, and that's how I got that nickname. So I had a lot of them, but Flying Freckle just kind of stuck as a kid going through it.
Yeah. Another thing I think of when I think of you and looking at you in the magazines is Troy painted one of your helmets, and on top said, "Who's bad?"
Yeah.
That was the Michael Jackson era.
Yeah. Yeah. I had Poison song on there, I think. I think I had Poison on the top or something, and one helmet, and Who's Bad? I had Bad Medicine, which was Bon Jovi. I had a couple things on the top of the helmet. A little segment in there of my life that the rocker stuff took over, I guess. But Who's Bad was on the top, and just Troy would always do some fun stuff or something like that. But that one was for a couple of years. A couple of my good years was the Who's Bad stuff.
Yeah.
So,
you know, we were talking earlier about the face mask and the Jova and all that. Remember, like, right towards the end of full open face helmets, the that Oakley
mask
came out that was just flat with the zigzags.
Scott had those at first.
Yeah, the Venturi.
I wore a Scott one back when I was on mini bikes, like the world, like our Race of Champions. I had them on with, I think, Scott goggles with the Scott mask. Burnsworth, a lot of guys wore the Scott mask at the time, and I had that for in mini bikes, and then went away from that, and then they came back for some reason with the Oakley mask. And Troy used to paint them up sometimes, because I'd have the green goggles, and then he'd have like a green fade to white.
Okay.
So I had like, he spray painted them colors and stuff, which was kind of cool. But they were, I didn't like them. I don't know why I wore them, because you couldn't breathe.
Yeah.
I mean, it's just on your face. It was hotter than a full face. I'd been better off wearing a full face.
Yeah.
If I was talking about air, you know, wanting to feel, it was just, I think something that maybe we had to wear for Oakley or something.
Yeah. But like when that came out, that product came out, I remember looking at it and going, good gosh, that's horrible looking. You know, it's just flat.
Yeah.
And then I saw a picture of you wearing it, and I'm all, that's the sickest thing ever. I'm getting on.
Yeah, I don't know why. It's, there's some photos that it actually looks pretty good, and you know, but most of the, it just really wasn't a good thing, like breathing wise. It fogged your goggles up. You had to, on the starting line, you had to breathe down because there was no air. It just went in, just went up, and your goggles started fogging, and or it went through the holes and fogged the outside, so you're trying to hold your breath and breathe down before the start. And once you got going, it was fine. But yeah, I don't know what the reasoning was before that. We wore that, but it was kind of cool for 6 months, I guess, maybe, or however long it lasted.
Okay, so now these days, there's a big interest with two strokes, right? Or like rebuilding old two strokes. And you know, the 500 two stroke is almost like a mythical machine, right? Like you raced factory 500s. And you also have raced and ridden 450s. Dude, how gnarly were the 500s?
Well, they were like riding a 125 on steroids. You know, I mean, I've ridden, you know, the four strokes, and I'll ride a two. It's the throttle control and the RPM, the awareness of where you have to be on the gears in the bike, even on a 500, compared to a 450, where, I mean, dang, if you're in, needed to be in second, but you were in third, you're fine. You know, it's just the bike, you just had to get a little more gas and it pulls out, but the two-stroke didn't work that way. You know, if you were in the wrong gear, and it would just, you know, and then you had to use the clutch, even on the 500. So it was it's like any two-stroke. You have to really, gear shifts are important, RPMs are important. Usually the more horsepower is way at the top of the RPM, where 450s, there's a you know, 9,000 RPM, then it drops, so the short shift works really good. And if you over-rev it, you don't lose a lot, but two-strokes were just all over the map to get it right. 500 was a tough bike to do. Just, we had to detune it a lot, the heavier crank, longer crank, just so that the power band would be longer and not so just, because the stock bike was like a 120. I mean, the shifting was so fast that it was just unrideable.
Yeah.
You know, and we really detuned it to make it to where you could just roll it on and use more momentum and speed than pure horsepower in each gear. But it's, they're just way harder to ride.
Yeah.
I mean, they're faster. I know. I mean, I know these bikes, as we've done Supermoto and, you know, Top Gear, it just gets around 100, whatever. But we just raced at Carlsbad
Superbikers
with the 500s. We hit 130 miles an hour.
Wow.
On those 500s, so they're fast.
Yeah.
Maybe on the track wise, because of torque and stuff, you know, 450 probably would be quicker. Mm-hmm. You know, I raced at Mammoth. I raced that service bike for Pro Circuit, back in like 08. I think I made one moto, my arms were so pumped I couldn't even ride the second moto. I was hanging on for dear life. I hole shot about like 15 bike lengths.
Yeah.
And then it was just a rattle trap vibration machine. it had that rigid frame, that 250 frame. It was, but they're just a beast of a bike to ride.
When you, like when I think of like 500 Nationals and stuff, like, oh God, the roost must have been so gnarly. In reality, is like, worse than a 450 race?
Or that's the same. I mean, a 125 roost hurts. It's like, you know, I mean, I think the 500 hurts so much. I mean, I just think because everybody was just swapping so bad, you know, it was shooting everywhere. These guys seem to stay a little straighter.
Yeah.
I don't know if the two-stroke was just a little more, you know, or maybe the tracks were just rockier. Our tracks were shittier. Mm-hmm. I mean, they didn't clean up any. I mean, nowadays everything's clean. Dirt looks good. There's some rocky, but we had some rocky tracks.
Yeah.
Binghamton, it was like, I remember getting behind Chandler Magoo. You couldn't get out of his roost because he was just going, I mean, it was just like a spray of water.
Yeah.
And it just hurt, you know. And a lot of times I didn't wear a chest protector, so it hurt even more. And a full face doesn't help either back in the day.
Yeah.
So it was a lot of pain, but these things are pretty brutal, the 450s. I think it's about equal, really.
Yeah.
I mean, 250 throws a big roost. It comes at you at about the same speed. I don't think you can tell if rock's getting thrown at you 5 miles an hour faster than the other bike.
Yeah.
It's still going to hurt depending on where it hits.
For sure. Okay, so we're running out of time, but like, what is your schedule like these days? I mean, I know you started off the year working with Joe Shimoda. Are you training other guys or?
Right now, no. I mean, Joe's, when this whole Corona thing happened, that was kind of when my contract ended, and we just kind of like, I'm not working with him anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So right now, I mean, I'm still help a couple guys out. I'm going back in June, back to Indiana for a couple kids I had out here for the amateur supercross stuff before that stopped, because I have the track up here at the old Troy Lee track that mm-hmm. I tamed down to an amateur track. So 65s can ride it and still do the jumps and stuff that they'll get similar to the futures deal, you know? Mm-hmm. So I'm gonna start ramping that up as soon as figure out what's going on.
Yeah.
So I'm in the same boat, you know, and I'm just doing my cycling, and I had some races planned. Sea Otter was supposed to be last week. It's not there. So I had some things on the schedule that I wanted to do, but I'm still probably next year I want to do something with the futures, because mm-hmm. I do have that supercross track. I have a 5,000 square foot shop over by the supercross tracks.
Mm-hmm.
And just put maybe a selected amount of guys, like 5 to 8 guys, for 2 months, you know, whenever the season's going to start, if it's November, and they're going to do the first, and then have them stay out there and just do like a camp.
Yeah.
And just do it that way instead of just picking one guy and doing this and that. And I like to help out more of the 65 guys, where I think I have more of a influence on the direction, you know, to mm-hmm. stop them from going maybe areas they couldn't. Once they get to pro, they've already kind of made their foundation and what they think they know, and then to make them to do stuff differently. It lasts for a while, but then they see something else, and it's like, I want to go try this. This looks funner. And
yeah.
There's no fun about it. It's hard work.
Yeah.
No matter where you go, you know, and it only gets harder when you get better, and you know, and then you got to beat that, and then it gets more pressure, and then there's more head gain. So it's a snowball effect until you. I mean, I had to figure it out every year. It was always something different, right? So, I'm probably going to start doing that a little bit. Maybe got a website going to be started up. My son Brandon's helping me on that, and get a package thing where maybe I can do stuff from on home. Mm-hmm. I mean, now that's how everybody's doing it. Now everything's on Zoom or whatever.
Yeah.
But that'll make me more accessible. Mm-hmm. That to where maybe somebody back east would never get to talk to me about something they had a question. Man, there's other people they can. I'm sure they have friends that know some and know somebody. But mm-hmm. I think to have something like that where maybe it's a monthly thing where they get to talk to me personally for whatever time or how it works, where I can answer questions and help them mm-hmm. out personally, and then do this little camp thing to where other people come and just kind of do some stuff to keep me in the bit, you know. I love motorcycles, so it's been my life, and I've never mm-hmm. left it. Even though I went car racing and did a bunch of other stuff, it's always been my family's backbone. My kids still ride, raced, mm-hmm. and did Loretta's and Punk, you know, and all that. So so I'm kind of just working on that. And
okay, so what is the website address going to be?
It's W3X Training.
W3X Training. Yeah. And then you're also accessible on Instagram DMs.
Yeah, DMs. And that's, I'm going to push it out there, and then hopefully else kind of push it. And then I'll just kind of, I'm going to try to, you know, maybe put something out to see what the interest is. I think that getting 5 to 7 guys to come ride a supercross track
mm-hmm.
and live, I know how many people travel the country and do stuff at other camps. I think that'll work out really well. Mm-hmm. But then just try this other thing to maybe we can do something online with the coaching, like everything else is online coaching and cycling apps and all the recording and what need to do. You just need somebody really to tell you what you need to be, you know, accountable.
Mm-hmm.
And if have somebody, you know, if you don't get back to them and you're paying for it, then hey, that's your loss.
Yeah.
You know, and if you have somebody to be accountable by and you respect that person, you tend to want to do it more than just by yourself. Mm-hmm. And I'm that way. That's why I did the cycling. Now I'm kind of accountable.
Yeah.
They gave me the what I need to do today. I still got to go out and do a 2-hour ride with mm-hmm. 15 or 20 sprint things in here, and I'm going to do it.
Yeah.
But if I didn't have this, I'd go, yeah, it sounds good, but I'll probably go home and go, you know, I'm going to go for an easy ride today, you know, or I just don't have a plan. So I think that's real important.
Structure.
Is having a plan and be accountable for what you want to do, and that's how you reach your goals. And
mm-hmm.
so that's kind of what I'm up to right now, but we'll see how it goes.
Cool. Well, hey, Jeff, thanks for coming on the show. You know, for me, a guy who grew up looking at you in the magazines and being so influenced by the ads with you and the pictures and stuff. I mean, it's been a thrill to become friends with you.
Thanks.
And to have you on the show.
Well, that's what it's all about. I mean, it's having an idol or somebody you look up to that you want to be. I mean, like I said in the beginning of the show with Marty Smith, that was why.
Yeah.
It's where I got to where I'm at today. Mm-hmm. And I think kids and everybody needs that idol. And if you are that idol, I talked about it in a little bit of my Instagram where Marty realized that I was his protege, and he took time all the time to come seek me and ask me if I needed this or that. If I went to him, he was always there. Mm-hmm. I told a little story about Oakland when I was racing Supercross, when I kind of got into Supercross. We were going up the starting line. I actually qualified better, and I was going to pick a gate, and I didn't. He was there, and he helped me pick a gate that he would have taken.
Uh-huh.
You know, and his wife, Nancy, was there, and she was like, why did you just help him?
Yeah.
And I felt kind of awkward, but he was like, he actually wanted me to succeed.
Yeah.
Because he knew how I looked up to him. And even to this day, when I'd see him, I still felt that same way, as if it was a comfort.
Yeah.
And he knew that, so it was super cool. And I'm in that kind of same thing. When you see kids, I'm not really relevant to maybe these kids, but even like you said, I could see how I get all the time on them. Oh, I remember you were on the wall. It's the only reason why I rode. And, you know, so it's pretty cool to give back, and he definitely did that for me. So
yeah.
For you to say that, it's really cool.
Awesome.
Appreciate it.
Okay, guys. Well, hey, thanks for watching. Make sure to check out swapmotolive.com. Set that in your bookmarks, and we'll see you next week.